Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming to DLNR for this news conference this afternoon. I'm Dan Dennison, the Senior Communications Manager, and I'll be your MC, so to speak, I guess. So we're going to talk about the Ohia fungus. It was discovered just very recently on Kauai. We have one speaker in the room with us today. That will be Rob Hoff, who is the protection forester, the state protection forester for the DLNR Division of Forestry and Wildlife. And then we have Lisa Keith, who is on the upper screen there. She's the research plant pathologist for the USDA Agricultural Research Service, and she's joining us obviously via video conference from Hawaii Island. And then Sherry Mann, who is on the other side, is the Kauai branch chief for the DLNR Division of Forestry and Wildlife, and she's joining us from Kauai. And so we'll do our normal drill. Rob's going to make a couple of opening comments, and then we'll go to Lisa to do the same, and then Sherry. And I think we had one person on the phone, and then Jessica Ells from the Garden Island is here on the phone joining us via FaceTime. So we have people all over the state. Sorry if the audio is not ideal, but it's the best we could do to do this multi-island news conference this morning. With that, Rob Hoff.
Good afternoon. Thanks for coming. Today we're breaking the sad news that one of the two fungal pathogens that is causing rapid Ohia death, the disease that is killing Ohia lehu on Hawaii Island, has been confirmed in Ohia trees on Kauai. Both forms of the disease cause what we refer to as rapid Ohia death, or ROD, or ROD. The discovery of what scientists refer to as Stratocystis juliohia on Kauai is serious, and in the coming weeks, agencies will be working to assess all of the data that's been gathered through aerial surveys and lab analyses to determine what can be done to limit spread on Kauai. Over the past week, we've activated a rapid response team of experts from state and federal agencies to investigate the death of several dead Ohia trees in the Molo'a'a Forest Reserve on Kauai, Kauai's northeastern side. On Wednesday, a multidisciplinary team from DLNR, USDA Agriculture Research Service, the University of Hawaii's College of Tropical Agriculture and Human Resources, the Kauai Invasive Species Committee, and the Nature Conservancy of Hawaii hiked into the forest reserve to get a closer look at these trees that were recently detected. Overnight testing from the samples that were gathered from the approximately 10 trees resulted in confirmation of an additional 3 trees with the pathogen causing rapid Ohia death, for a total of 5 dead trees with rapid Ohia death diagnosed. So now I'll turn it over to Dr. Lisa Keith in Hilo.
Thanks, Rob. So on Kauai Island, we have identified 2 fungal pathogens associated with dead and dying Ohia trees. The first is called Ceratocystis leucoohia, which was formerly species A, and the second is Ceratocystis juliohia, which we used to call species B, and juliohia is what is now found on Kauai. So on Kauai Island, rapid Ohia death was actually a coined term to describe the rapid onset of symptoms. So trees were dying rapidly, hence rapid Ohia death. After extensive research, we now know that the 2 fungal pathogens on Kauai Island cause 2 different diseases. However, both pathogens enter trees through wounds, and both pathogens can kill trees. Leucoohia is more aggressive. It gets into a wound, it rapidly goes throughout the tree, and kills the tree very quickly. Juliohia, again the one found on Kauai, can get into a wound, it spreads more slowly, but it does kill trees. So both species on Kauai Island are found widespread. However, it's Ceratocystis leucoohia that actually is associated with areas of large mortality. Again, juliohia is what is found on Kauai.
Sherry?
Yes.
Take it away.
Thank you. So we found what we're calling juliohia. Juliohia like Rob and Lisa said, in the Molawa'a version or section of the island, that's sort of the northeast. It's in a forest reserve. We found our botanist Adams came across a group of dead-looking ohia, and took some samples and sent those in to Lisa's lab, and she quickly realized what we were looking at. And soon after that, there was a wonderful convergence of partnerships that was with Lisa's lab, JB Friday from CTAR, and the Nature Conservancy, the Kauai Island Invasive Species Committee, and National Tropical Botanical Garden, and quite a few staff from Kauai Division of Forestry and Wildlife. So we went out and took some more samples, and really we did some drone flying, and we flew in a helicopter over the area to try and better understand what we're looking at, the spatial area, if it's beyond that. Some more samples were sent back to Lisa's lab, and there was again some confirmation that it was Julio Ohia. So we're confident of what we're looking at, which is the less aggressive species and not the more aggressive species. So for that, we're quite thankful. We have a lot to learn. We have a lot to do, and we're going to take this systematically, work with our partners, accept any and all advice from the Big Island and other experts from around the world, and really try and understand if it is just in that region of the island, or perhaps if it's beyond there. Some people are thinking that it's possible that it could have been here a while, and maybe something that we just didn't know that was here. But like I said, we have a lot to learn and lot of things to do. So I think what's really most important is that we have a lot of support, and we're going to use new technologies, old technologies, and bring in partners like the county and others in order to get the best information out to the public, the most scientifically rigorous, and make sure that we talk about what we know, not what we don't know. So I think that's all I have to share right now.
Okay, Lisa and Sherry, if you'd stand by there, and we'll open the floor to questions. Tim?
Yeah, can you characterize the difference in the aggressiveness between the two species? Like, does one kill twice as fast, three times as fast?
Okay, Lisa, did you hear that question?
So I believe the question is asking about the aggressive nature of the two species.
Yes.
And just to give a little more information, Ceratocystis leucoohia, the more aggressive of the two species, when you look actually at the family tree of fungi, there are many examples of not only that, but other important tree diseases caused by similar ceratocystis. Okay, it's known as a vascular wilt. Again, it gets inside, it moves very quickly. And on some experiments, we're seeing that with a high concentration of fungi getting in, trees could die in a matter of months. That's not the case with Ceratocystis julioohia. Once the fungus gets in, it really slowly starts to move compared to leucoohia. So we're talking a much longer time frame for the tree to die. But I think what is tricky with this coined rapid ohia death, again, it's the symptomology that we see something happening on the outside, this dead canopy, quite quickly. Trees look healthy, and then it seems like in a matter of weeks, the tree looks dead. But in fact, what's going on in the inside is a different story. Both fungi still need to get in and start cutting off the water supply system. And the more aggressive leucoohia does that far more quickly than julioohia.
Others?
Well, what is being done to try to stop this, and what sort of resources are being put into stopping it?
Rob, do you want to take that one?
Sure.
Thanks.
So because the disease is a complex issue right now, we're analyzing the data that we've gathered from the aerial surveys so we can determine the extent of the infestation. After we've been able to better delineate where the dead trees are found, we need to go in and survey on the ground and take samples so we can verify whether it was the pathogen that killed those trees or not. Once we've gathered all of that data, which will take some time because it's a very rugged area, we'll better be able to determine what the right approach is. And there is no one recipe that's going to fit any landscape where this disease is. So we're really going to have to work with our partners, especially the science team, to best assess how to go in and certainly not make the situation worse.
So at this point, it's more study than actual
Correct.
Attacking the fungus.
Additional surveys, yeah.
Okay. How much funds are being put into this?
Sure. So we're fortunate that we have been funded this past year. We have a variety of different funders who are helping the project, state, federal, and private foundations. And we've tucked away a little bit of funding for exactly this type of situation, so that when there is a new outbreak on another island, we're prepared to go after it and do what it takes to contain it. So we do have resources available for it, and we'll be channeling those toward our both DLNR branch on Kauai and our partners.
Do we have any numbers?
Because we haven't determined the budgetary needs, we have about 170,000 specifically for the rapid response effort, but we have other funds that we can certainly channel to Kauai as needed. And coming into this next fiscal year, there will be additional funds available, and we'll be working on that budget and balancing what's going on Hawaii Island with the new detection on Kauai, and well as ramping up things on Oahu and Maui, I should add. You know, with this find on Kauai, we really need to do a more intensive job surveying on those islands as well.
Jen, just to follow up, and if I could have Lisa address it, there is no treatment or cure for this disease right now. So Lisa, could you expand on that for a moment?
Yes, that's true for actually any psoriasis tree diseases currently known. Prevention is far better than a cure because there is no cure. So the better thing to do is to keep Ohia as healthy as possible. I mean, as even for people, not to wound trees if possible, don't landscape. Don't prune unless absolutely necessary. With wood, don't start moving firewood around because the fungus is in the wood. It can go to a new place. And including, you know, sometimes the fungi can be found in small pieces of wood in the soil. So you can wash boots, sanitize them with alcohol, get mud out of your vehicle wheels and wheel arches prior to moving to new areas.
Thanks, Lisa. Others? Tim? Oh, sorry. Melanie?
Sorry. Do we know if, for some reason, this fungus can be carried on wildlife? I mean, could they be carrying the fungus to different islands? Is this something that's being looked at as a possibility?
That's a new question. I don't know. Lisa, I guess?
Did you want to try that?
Did you hear that, Lisa?
It's been quiet, but I think the question is, can it actually hitch a ride on animals?
Yes.
Probably in the smallest possibility, I would say yes, more particularly if it was mud being carried by animals. We definitely have not done extensive swabbing of animals, but believe it or not, we have even looked at some goats, tried to swab it off of horns. We've never picked it up off of animals.
Tim?
Yes, do you suspect this outbreak on Kauai spread over from the Big Island? And if so, is that surprising?
And Lisa, I think you should take that one as well, please.
Okay, so do I think it spread from the Big Island? To be honest, when we started studying Rapid Ohia Death back in 2014, we were alerted to large stands of Ohia trees that had rapidly died. And early on, we were finding psoriasis leucoohia. And it was probably more than at least half a year that we actually found our first case of hulioohia. So as time has gone on, while psoriasis hulioohia can be found in almost every district on Hawaii Island, the mortality we see due to hulioohia is very scattered, okay? So the current hypothesis is that we probably found psoriasis hulioohia because we started looking at widespread mortality areas caused by psoriasis leucoohia. So the timeline of introduction of a pathogen that might have been killing a tree here or there, there are other pathogens that cause trees to die and other natural reasons, trees senesce and die. So it is possible that hulioohia was on the Big Island and perhaps even throughout the state for a much longer time than this recent outbreak of large amounts of trees dying in areas. And so what is common for the Big Island, new outbreaks, particularly from the air, because there are a lot of trees dying in an area. And more often than not, I would say 99% of the trees, when we sample and test, we find psoriasis leucoohia, but an occasional few will be psoriasis hulioohia. Now that makes you start to think, well, if we weren't really alerted to the area because of the more aggressive pathogen, would we really even suspect a second pathogen hulioohia? So the origins of these fungi are currently unknown. That's an area of further research. We know where the closest genetic cousins exist in the world, but we still don't know how they came to Hawaii or actually in on what material to come here. So I think long answer short, right now it's really too early to tell what island it started on and spread to.
Is there a possibility that, I mean, you've got the two islands on either end of the chain, Big Island and then Kauai. Is it possible that Ohia or Rapid Ohia Death could be here and we have not found it yet? I mean, I heard someone mention that there is a possibility that it was already on Kauai and that it may not have been brought there from the Big Island. So is it possible, given the majority of our Ohia plant that we have on Oahu are up in, you know, areas where people don't necessarily go a lot?
Yeah. Rob, do you want to take that one?
Sure.
Thanks.
Yeah, that's definitely a possibility.
You know, as far as...
Oh, go ahead.
No, go ahead, Rob. Right.
It's definitely a possibility, and we've been running surveys, aerial surveys, across all of the Ohia forests in the state twice a year, trying to pick up those. Sometimes you see a dead tree in a really remote area and it's hard to get in to sample and verify what killed the tree. And so that's always a struggle because you do need that on the ground confirmation of what the tree died for. So I think that there's gonna be definitely a concerted ramping up of surveys on the other islands now that we've had this detection on Kauai, and we hope to get more trees tested and validate whether it is present on these other islands where we haven't yet had a detection.
Bob, can I ask you, how serious is this? I mean, I know it was a big deal. Thousands of acres of Ohia forest were being killed off by rot, and then now we're discovering, unfortunately, a second island. Can you tell us how serious that is?
Sure. I mean, I think it's very serious that we've detected a pathogen that we know can kill Ohia on an island where we didn't know it existed before. If there's any silver lining to this, it's that it isn't the more aggressive form that causes widespread mortality and kills trees very quickly. However, we're still going to treat this very serious. It's a new incursion of a tree-killing disease, and we're going to continue to survey and come up with a strategy on how best to deal with the situation.
Others? Tim, did you have another question? That answered, okay. And Jessica, do you have any questions? I'm not sure how well you can hear, but I see her, but the signal's not very good. So, okay, go ahead, Tim.
When exactly was the find? How long ago did Adam Williams discover this?
Sherry, did you hear that?
I think the question was, when was it found?
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
A couple weeks ago, Adam went to the area to actually take some samples of the trees. But he saw a sort of unusual looking area of some dead ohia. I think it was late January. But we don't really have a lot of staff who have gone through some of the sample training, and of course we've had tremendous weather here on Kauai, and we also had to get landowner access to the area. It's a landlocked area, so for a number of reasons we didn't get out and actually sample it. But once we did, we knew within a week what we were dealing with. Lisa's lab was excellent, and within 2 days of the notice that we actually had a positive sample, we had people from the Big Island here running some drones and on the ground. And then within 4 days, Lisa and her crew and JB Friday and others were here. So as soon as we knew, it's been a tremendous response, but it took us a little while. The other thing, you know, we've been doing digital sketch mapping across the island for over a year, and we've been using ohia forest distributions of where to fly. And, you know, these forests grow and change, and this actual section was not on our map in terms of an ohia forest. And it's very scattered. It's not a solid ohia forest. It's mixed with ulupe and some non-native trees. So, you know, it didn't show up in some of our earlier sketch mapping efforts, but we're going to be working to improve those ohia distribution maps along with our partners, and putting in a lot more time and using the technologies that we have to be doing more surveying.
Yes, getting back to the aggressiveness again, if the aggressive one kills in a matter of months, how long the less aggressive one?
Lisa, did you catch that?
So, the aggressive one can kill in a matter of months when we put in a high concentration of the fungus, okay? So we're still trying to get a better understanding of, in nature, how much fungus is necessary to even start infections and how long that natural process takes. But what we've seen with colonization patterns in wood, with our experiments, within the months where Ceratocystis leucoohia essentially colonizes, now you can see very typical internal discoloration or wood staining. You're actually looking at the fungus growing throughout the wood. With leucoohia, we could find staining throughout the entire tree, okay? As opposed to huliohia, which may be moved 2 to 3 feet from the point of infection, okay? So if it were just a single wound at a single entry point for the fungus, I mean, I could venture a guess it could perhaps take years to actually do enough damage to cut off the water supply. But again, a reminder, you know, the outward symptoms are the same. You end up seeing brown leaves on trees. So I, you know, echo the same sentiments that samples need to be tested to verify the species that's actually present. And so even with the Kauai trees, they were dead trees. And what seemed like long dead trees, the wood's very dry, and some of the samples are just hard to work with just because they've been dead for a long time. So yes, Julio here definitely not as aggressive as we grow here.
What type of economic impact could this have potentially on our state, on our economy?
Rob, do you want to address that?
I mean, if it kills all these trees on the Big Islands, if it kills, you know, more trees on Kauai.
Okay, first Deputy Bob Masuda from DLNR is going to address that question.
Okay.
I think there's an economic impact in terms of the beauty of Hawaii and all of that. But I think the seriousness of this is really around the fact that Ohia is our foundation tree for our watershed. It's 80% of the trees that cover 1 million acres of watershed. And so you can just begin to picture what it means for a watershed. Without Ohia gathering the water into our aquifer, the best water in the world is threatened. And that's our real concern.
Other questions?
When it comes to the two fungi on the Big Island, most are the more aggressive fungus that are killing off the trees there? Is it a small
percentage? Seems to be because of the aggressive. Luku comes from like Wailuku, rushing river, aggressive. That's why Luku is aggressive. Huli is turning over a little slower, kind of like Huli Huli chicken, you know. So when you consider speed, you have to consider overall. It's hard to tell the impact, as Dr. Keith said. But she's on it. She's been working, you know, day and night on this. We have our A team. I think gathering from the questions and the interest that our media folks have shown, what I'm going to suggest is that you let your interest be known to Dan, and we will take a visitation group of media from our four major stations. You guys are going to have to decide. We cannot fit all cameras on one helicopter, but we'll try to accommodate. But I'd like to invite all our major stations to come on a science visitation tour like we did with the legislature. Have you looked through electron microscopes, see how this thing actually clutters, and it's like arteriosclerosis on steroids. You know, it kills all the vertical vascular system of Ohia, and that's why the leaves die and the branches dry up and fall down. So if you're interested, let Dan know. He'll coordinate, and between he and Rob, we'll arrange for a thorough visitation so you can look at it from a landscape point of view, go through the Carnegie Airborne Observatory science on how we're looking at a broad scale, because we've already taken a airborne observatory picture of East Maui several months ago, just not because of any warnings, but just so we know what is there now. Should something happen, we can get ahead of the game. Okay? Because this is a containment strategy. We're kind of under siege, slow siege. They're trying to starve us out. We're trying to break the siege. So if you look at it from that point of view, I think you can understand the dynamics of the challenge. But I think the most important thing is getting you folks to see and feel what it's like to have our watershed threatened.
Dan, we have a question here.
Yes. From Jan.
Hi, Dan. This is Jan Timbrugan, Kate. The question, I guess, I may be beating a dead horse here, but is there any hope that one of these species inoculates against the other? Is there any Ohia that is resistant, or is it the case that once infected, every tree will die?
Sounds like a Lisa question.
Okay, so the answer to the first question, no. As far as one fungus knocking out the other fungus, unfortunately, no. They both, in their own right, are pathogens that can kill trees. And in rare occasions, we actually do find both in a single tree. Okay. As far as resistance, you know, I think the overall picture is so much better than what we expected once we started in 2014. We've done our first round, actually, of seedling inoculations, looking at different varieties. Definitely there's hope. Varieties respond differently. Certain seedlings haven't died yet more than a year after testing. You know, and I think that's also locations in the forest. Not every tree dies in heavily hit areas. And there really is a lot of healthy forest on Hawaii Island.
Tim, can you roughly break down the percentage by species of the Big Island Rapid Ohia Death?
I think that's another Lisa question.
I'm sorry, was the question percentage of species of the fungus?
Yes.
Okay, my uneducated guess, I would say 90%+ is due to psoriasis dislucoochia, and the other amount over years would be then psoriasis dislucoochia. But again, the widespread mortality we see on island is due to psoriasis dislucoochia, the vascular adult pathogen.
That's the more aggressive one, right?
Yes.
Yes.
One of the things we also want to share with you is, on one hand, while we're having Dr. Keith and her team work on control and hopefully agent to, you know, deal with the fungus, we're also having U.S. Forest Service scientists and folks from places like the Akaka Foundation for Tropical Forests, Nature Conservancy, and others working together in trying to breed and grow in nurseries disease-resistant trees. So if we have little seedlings and stuff coming up around trees that have resisted the disease, you know, amongst all the dead trees, then we want to see what's happening there. So we have all of these different kinds of efforts around saving our watershed. The objective is to protect our watershed and to protect our ohia. If we can't have the trees resist this, and as we contain it, we need to have other trees that can grow healthily in its place. So we're looking at all of those things. And we do think seriously that, you know, this might be a very interesting visit for you folks to take a look at and get the whole scale and the whole scope of this. Because the public needs to understand that without our watershed, we're going to be like what I had to drink in Chicago when I lived there, you know, recycled water. And believe me, recycled water smells a lot stronger with chlorine, that strong chlorine. We are so blessed in Hawaii to have wonderful water, and that's our goal, that's our mission. We need to conserve, protect our natural resources. The public needs to get it. You folks need to help us connect them from A to B to C. So we invite you to join us in this educational opportunity. Thank you all for being here.
Nope, we're not quite that long.
Oh, okay.
Thank you. So other questions? Anyone else? For the media, I just wanted to point to the two pages after the news release, and that's just resources, photographic and video resources that are available. And that's from Wednesday when we were out with the field teams where they were doing training out in the affected area. So you're free to use any of that material as you see fit. And with that, I think we're all done. Thank you very much for coming this afternoon.